Hey everyone, so I was browsing around the internet and I recently read an article on digitalaudioreview.net about a program called Musicscope, made by a company named Xivero. And it's a piece of software for music analysis, and it's actually pretty cool, so I thought I would show you it. The software itself is pretty simple. All the data is presented to you on the essentially the same screen, so you can get some interesting insights about any given track with the program. So I'll start by showing you the track A Stroll Through the Sky from the Howl's Moving Castle soundtrack, which is a Studio Ghibli animated film. And if you remember, back when I did a blind test with some of my friends, a blind test comparison between 128k AAC and lossless files, my friend Thomas used this particular piece of music for his ABX test, and he was able to achieve a score of 8 out of 10. So it wasn't a statistically significant result, but the result did seem to suggest that he was able to some degree to differentiate between the lossy and the lossless file. And if we had better conditions, perhaps he could have achieved a statistically significant result. But apparently, Stroll Through the Sky is a track that is well mastered enough for you to be able to pick up on those details. And I'll just play you a bit of that track. So as you can hear, it is a orchestral recording. And so what you'll notice is, and what Musicscope will show you, is that there's actually not a great deal of high frequency sound in most of this recording. So you see here, it tells you the cutoffs and the frequencies. We have about, you know, from the space of 11 kilohertz to 22 kilohertz, there's not a great deal of things happening. But there are some isolated high frequency peaks, so it's easy for us to listen for things like cymbal shimmer and that kind of thing, and that's probably what helped pick up some of the issues that you get with lossy encoding, particularly around high frequency tracks. So we just have a bit of space to listen to the high frequency sounds and get a sense of, you know, the air or anything like that. What's also very interesting on this track is that it has a very high dynamic range, as you would expect from an orchestral recording. But basically, what Musicscope can give us is the LRA figure for a track, and that is the loudness range. And this is the measure of contrast between the softest and the loudest passages of recording, and it's a metric developed by the European Broadcasting Union. And it's determined by a statistical distribution of measured loudness in a given track. And it's a really clever algorithm because it does things like reject long passages of silence or very short sounds. So instead of just telling you bluntly what is the difference between the softest and loudest sounds in a track in terms of decibels, it calculates the range of the distribution of loudness levels in a track by estimating the differences between the 10th and the 95th percentile of the distribution of the loudness sample. So in this case, the LRA tells us that there is a range of about 23 decibels between the softest 10% and the loudest 5% of the loudness samples in this piece of music. And we can actually see that here. We have this histogram here that shows us the distribution of loudness samples on the track, and we have the LRA figure here. So in terms of macro dynamics, this track has a very high dynamic range, again, what you would expect from an orchestral recording. So it seems to be a good recording, but there's a number of interesting things about this that this software can tell you. So this software can tell you a bit about whether or not this recording in particular would benefit from being mastered at a higher resolution. So this track is a recording with a 16-bit bit depth and a 44 kilohertz sample rate. But you can tell this track actually has a lot of headroom. So from 0 to 6 decibels below full scale, there's actually no data there. And if we actually switch to the bit monitor, we can actually see that one or two of these bits are grayed out. So what that actually means is that this recording, even though it's a 16-bit track, it has an effective bit rate of only about 14 to 15 bits. Now, it's possible that when they were mastering this this recording, they applied dynamic range compression to fit it within 14 or 15 bits. By the same token, you can also tell that the microphones used for this recording did not actually pick up much information beyond 20 kilohertz. So we see here about like 20 kilohertz. That's really where the cutoff is for the microphones they use for this recording. Now, note that there's nothing in the high frequencies which is being cut off above 22 kilohertz, which is actually the limit of a recording of a 44.1 kilohertz sampling rate. So even if there was a 96 kilohertz version of this track, again, I don't think there would be much benefit because it looks like the microphone simply didn't pick up any data above those frequencies. And that's typical because most microphones are designed to pick up frequency ranges that map to human hearing. So what you can tell from this kind of track is that this is a well-recorded track. Thomas was able to use this track to great benefit, along with his very expensive custom earphones, to get a pretty good ABX result, all things considered. But you can tell high-resolution recordings are not a magic wand that improve audio quality. If there was a 9624 version of this track, I don't think it would actually render any sort of appreciable difference. What this tells you is that in order to improve audio quality, what's most important is we focus on what happens during the recording and the mastering stage, which is why this whole time I've been complaining about high resolution audio, because it distracts us from the things that actually matter, what we'd like to see from music, i.e. better recording and better mastering quality and not necessarily more fancy and expensive electronics. We can have really good sounding recordings that fit within the 1644 limits of CD quality. So we can actually contrast this recording with this particular track I have here. This is Zebra by Oniotrix Point Never from the album R+7, and this is one of my favorite electronic albums. And again, I'll play you a bit of this track. So I have this album in a 24-bit, 44 kilohertz format, and what's interesting about this particular track is just the sheer density of the musical information in this track, which you can hear yourself, and you can see on the spectrogram. You can see it's just a giant green block here. It's a track with, again, quite a high macro dynamic range. If I go ahead and just fast forward this entire thing, so we'll scan through the entire track, you can see actually that the macro dynamic range of this particular recording has an LRA of about 12.9, which is quite high for, I guess, for the kind of music it is, the kind of electronic recording it is. What's interesting is that you can see it's a 24-bit track and it uses almost all 24 bits of the dynamic range. So the softest music in this recording is about 100 decibels below the loudest noise, and I can't really tell whether the really quiet stuff below 100 hertz, and if I just play that again, I can't tell if the stuff below this 100 hertz line here is actually just noise or it's actual music. So you can also tell just looking at the spectrogram here that this track is really obviously cut off at 22 kilohertz. It's just a hard cutoff here. Everything's just been blunted. And the high frequency peaks of this track, around 22 kilohertz, are only about 60 decibels below full scale, meaning that conceivably they are audible. And if you had a 96 kilohertz version of this track, there would be plenty of information left over above 22 kilohertz, which is not making it into this track. So as long as you could find audio gear that could reproduce frequencies above 22 kilohertz, and you had ears that could hear above 22 kilohertz, you could conceivably have an even more amazing experience with this particular track. Now, obviously this track reaches the limits of the format, the 44 kilohertz sampling rate, because it's composed of synthesized instruments. But this is typically not the track we would consider as an audiophile track, because what I love about this album is that all the synths sound like they're samples from Windows 95. Now the last track I'll kind of show you is Fly Away from the Pantheon Stocking album. And of course you want to know what a badly mastered recording looks like on this software. So again, I'll just play you a bit of it. Fly away now, fly away now, fly away. So you can tell just by hearing it immediately that this is a really hotly mastered track. The software actually can show us exactly what's going on. For one thing, this track, and if you look at here on this circular radar kind of screen here, this track just continually peaks the entire way through. It continually clips against full scale. So you just get this red line the whole way through. And that means the track is clipping the whole time. And if we fast forward again, we can see it just, it's pretty funny. It's literally a red line. And if you played it back through bad equipment, you would probably cause even more distortion just because it might, some equipment clips when you get close to full scale. The other thing about this track is that it has an LRA of about 2.3. And that means there is roughly a spread of about 2.3 decibels of dynamic range in this entire track, which is, that's pretty crazy. So here's the question, is this a badly mastered track? Now, this is where I think it gets interesting because it certainly looks like a terrible track on paper. If we have a look at this software, it just looks terrible. But honestly, to me, it sounds like it's mastered perfectly well for what it's meant to be. Because Fly Away is meant to be a really brash, disposable sounding dance track. And it sounds exactly like it was being played through bad speakers in a nightclub, which I imagine was the intention behind the mastering of this particular track. Because you don't master something and just see this clipping level the whole way through and not notice it. Like, I'm an amateur and I would notice when I was mastering something that it clipped continually. There's a lot of tracks that are like this. For instance, one of my favorite tracks is DVNO by the band Justice, and it's another track that's been deliberately mastered to sound really bad. And again, I'll play you just a bit of that. And what I really like about this track is that it's horribly mastered so that it's meant to recall the sound of an old school French discotheque. And to me, this is one of the most cleverly mastered tracks that I've heard because it has deliberate flaws that are not just in terms of dynamic range compression, not just in terms of, those kinds of things, but also they've added things like phase shifting in the bass and that kind of thing. Just imagine if you had a really bad speaker system, this is what it would do to your music, and it's just been recorded that way. And if we fast forward through the whole track, you can see it looks pretty terrible, and it gets a LRA figure of 1.6, which is, by some standards, I guess, appalling. But again, I really like this track. So when people say, or when people complain about the loudness wars and things like that, and a lot of people have asked me about my opinion on them, I've always said a lot of time bad mastering isn't necessarily because the producer doesn't know what they're doing, because they might be trying to recreate a certain feel or a certain aesthetic, and they can achieve that using techniques to introduce flaws in the same way that people might use photo filters on Instagram, or when you're color grading a film, you might deliberately crush the blacks to create a certain atmosphere. And of course, people can always overuse an aesthetic to the point where it becomes cliche or annoying, like using a lot of lens flare, or some people really do hate Instagram filters, or sepia toning in a film. And in the case of music, I think a lot of people are just tired of people overusing dynamic range compression on every single album until everything sounds like sludge, and it's become a bit of a cliche at this point. But I've noticed a lot of people just kind of claim it as if the recording engineers don't know what they're doing, and I really don't think that's the case. I don't think it's as simple as that. So I think this kind of discussion is really interesting, and it always comes down to that debate between objectivity and subjectivity and authorial intent and blah, blah, blah. But what I think is cool is that this kind of software in particular does allow you to have more of an insight into the music that you listen to, which is always cool. And I use this now to just gain an idea of what went behind some of the mastering behind this track. Now, Musicscope is available on Mac and PC. It is somewhat expensive. It is the full version of this software, it's €24, which I guess isn't much in the grand scheme of things, but it seems like a lot in the age of $2 apps on the App Store. So It's also lacking support for some features that I really do hope get introduced in later updates, like support for AAC files. Currently, it doesn't support AAC files. And I wish it had the ability to jump or rewind to specific sections of the track so that you could listen to them again or listen to specific frequency ranges and that kind of thing. But I've been in contact with the people at Xivero with suggestions, and hopefully if there are more kind of geeky people like me who get to use this software, it'll become more fully featured over time. Anyway, I have links to the software and the music used in this video in the description of the video below. I hope you found this interesting, and I look forward to your comments. You can talk to me on Facebook at facebook.com/LachlanLikesAThing, on Twitter at LachLikesAThing. Thanks to all my regular subscribers, and happy listening.